Hello there, good afternoon. You're watching Proactive London. Paul Larbey is joining us today from Bango because we've got plenty to discuss. But your first half trading, wow, what a bonanza that you've had. Revenue jumped 49% in the first half of 2021, really with end user spending increasing across all of your payment platforms. So we're going to delve into all of that and much, much more, your partnerships with the likes of Amazon. So you must be really pleased, Paul.
Yeah, I mean, a great first half of the year. We gave our trading update yesterday ahead of the full results, which will be delivered in September. Like I said, revenue 50% up on last year, just over 7 million. End user spend, which is a measure of that, the volume of the transactions through the platform, but also an important measure of the data pot that we have to monetize as we in the Bango marketplace business. Again, you know, great growth up at 1.3 billion, and both of that together generate, you know, the power of the platform being that we can add more and more of this business on, and a lot of it drops straight to the bottom line. So that allowed us to show, you know, great EBITDA, almost double the EBITDA, really strong cash position. We have no debt, and so we basically have everything we need to, you know, continue that investment and continue powering forward with our growth by reinvesting from the success we're having on the platform.
Brilliant. Continue the investment, as you say. And now I know you've experienced an increase in activity through the lockdown, very much the nature of what you're doing, and maybe it's to be expected. Have you noticed then a change in spending patterns as restrictions have eased, Paul?
Yeah, I think the answer is no. We've always said all along ago that based on the data we had and based on similar things that have happened in the past, not with the same sort of length of lockdown that we've seen from the COVID-19 experience, but we also said that basically events like this drive people to mobile commerce and then they stay there. They may buy different things at different times, but fundamentally they've made that conversion to mobile commerce. And that's exactly what we've seen. I think the results we've just reported are still evident to this. The people that use the mobile commerce for the first time are still there. They're still spending. And say the results are a great proof point to that. And one of the things they're really spending on is subscriptions and entertainment services, you know, games, music, video entertainment services, where, you know, that subscription bundling business is for us has never been a bigger part of our growth.
Good to hear. Now, last time we talked about the Xbox launch. How's that going?
It's going really well, yeah. In the first half, we launched four routes with Xbox, launching their Game Pass Unlimited, which is a streaming subscription service for games, allowing you to access those games on any platform through a streaming service. And I think really evidence is that gaming is the latest streaming service and the latest streaming subscription service. And that couples nicely with the continued rollout of 5G, you know, not just have the data pipe to support those streaming services, but a nice subscription to bundle the gaming service with, a 5G data package. And if you add on to that, you know, what we're launching at the moment, which is where you can bundle a console in and basically subsidize a console over a 2-year period as part of that game subscription with what Microsoft call Xbox All Access, then it's really sort of fueling the growth for gaming, which is, you know, become the next and latest sort of streaming subscription service. We had music, then obviously went to video with all the different video providers, and now gaming. And I think you look at, you know, what was announced a few days ago with Netflix, them looking to enter the gaming market, bundling basically games, if you like, as a different genre along with their video content. That connecting of multiple services together, trying to provide the best customer experience, you know, is exactly what we've been doing with, you know, by bringing multiple parties together for some time. So I think everything's, you know, everything's pointing in the right direction. The strategy we set out a couple of years ago regarding that bundling is absolutely where the market is going, and it's never been hotter than it is at the moment.
Paul, you also announced additional Amazon services with four new payment providers. Can you tell us more about the impact adding new merchants and payment providers into the platform? What, as a business, what is the impact?
So we made it really easy to bring both new payment providers and new merchants on the platform. And we're working with Amazon as part of their bundling services for an awful long time now, and have done sort of incredible numbers all over the world. And what we generally find, and you know, there's a couple of nice examples of this, is when somebody's connected into the platform, they get access to everybody on the side. So when a new merchant connects into the platform, they get access into everybody that's connected on sort of the payment provider side. And what we've seen with some of the Xbox, but also some of these Amazon routes, is it's brought new payment providers on. So now those payment providers cannot just get access to, you know, the Xbox or the Amazon for which we originally did the connection, but to all the other merchants connected to the Bango platform. So we have this sort of fan in, fan out sort of scale benefit, where the more and more people connected to the platform, the more everybody benefits.
Another thing that we've got to talk about today, and we've discussed it before in the past, is Bango Marketplace. So I understand this has grown substantially. Maybe tell us a bit more about this growth of the business and how you've managed to achieve this.
So Bango Marketplace is the use of the payment data. So from processing all those payments we've talked about, we generate this big pool of payment data. We can then look inside that pool of payment data and generate insights, which are really useful for people running marketing campaigns, and in particular, sort of app developer marketing campaigns. So it's the second half of what we've spoken about before about our virtuous circle. Always have the one half of processing the payments. The second half, we're using those insights to help the marketing people become more successful, then in itself generates more payments. So it's sort of really helping using purchase data and payment history to target marketing campaigns. We call that purchase behavior targeting. The one thing we issued in along with the trading update was a commentary on what we call Bango audience days, which is sort of a measure of how many of our different audiences of paying users are in use on any particular day with different app developers running different campaigns. And that saw a 10x growth over the first 6 months of the year, which I think is just real testament to the power of purchase behavior targeting and the power of the data that we have within the platform.
That's impressive. Gosh. Right. Something that I do want to address with you, because it's something that a lot of people are talking about, is, of course, the changes with third-party cookies and those Apple have made with their app IDs as well. How does this impact Bango then?
Yeah, I think very, very simply positively, but let me step back and sort of try and give it a little bit of context. We've actually just published a study we call Board to Death, which is sort of a C-level suite and board level view of how they view digital marketing. And what we saw from that is around two-thirds of CEOs think their money's wasted on digital marketing campaigns. And so there's an increasing drive to get a better return on that advertising campaign and to demonstrate, you know, real revenue. So not just finding users or people who like, but finding people who are actually going to pay for the services you're trying to market. And in any campaign, data is really key to the success of that marketing campaign. And what we're seeing with some of the changes you just talked about, third-party cookies, the changes that Apple made in iOS 14 to sort of anonymize the app ID, and basically taking away huge sources of data that the marketing teams traditionally used to help them in those campaigns. What that means is actually the data we have is even more valuable. The data we have is completely not impacted by that. Our campaigns have seen no change in performance since Apple made the change, for example, just as we didn't expect them to, because it's a very different way of using data. And I think the marketing teams are now hungry for more sources of data and are sort of starting to wake up to the power of, you know, this purchase behavior targeting and helping them really focus in and find those paying users, not just people who click like or browse. So it's, you know, buyers versus browsers.
Buyers versus browsers. I like that. In regards to something you mentioned earlier, Paul, you were talking about reinvesting, because of course you have had this strong growth, and in turn that comes with reinvesting. It gives you the opportunity to do that. You're hiring at a rapid rate. So maybe tell us how working life has changed over the past sort of 12 months at Bango, and indeed everybody else as well, but particularly where you are. What's it like now?
Yeah, so I mean, I think we've seen lots of changes over the last 12 or 18 months. You know, particularly we're going through huge growth, we're bringing on lots more new people. And, you know, one of the hardest things about scaling a company is scaling a company, but keeping the culture, keeping it a special place to work, keeping it a place where everybody wants to work. And especially given the last 18 months, we've all been sort of distributed back to our houses. That's become even more difficult. So we've put a lot of effort into that over the last 18 months. How do we bring on new people where some of them have never met anybody else who's in the company? And hopefully that will change in the next couple of months as we start to, you know, move back into offices. But how do we keep that culture? How do we make sure we bring in the right people? And so we've tried all sorts of things. We've made sure, you know, there's a big focus on well-being, so everybody's safe and well and looked after and safe. We focused a lot on different virtual events to try and keep the culture going. And we recently just completed our annual employee engagement survey, where we got the highest score we ever get. That sort of measures sort of employee satisfaction across a whole range of topics that really aligned with our Thrive values. And I say highest score ever, 100% participation, which itself is a measure of the level of engagement. So, you know, really pleased with that. And I think the team have done an incredible job, not just on the delivering results, but in, you know, maintaining that, this thing that makes Bango special and such a fun place to work and allows us to continue to deliver such great results, because we have a team who are focused on delivering, focused on execution and focused on success.
Paul, you're thriving.
Absolutely. And yeah, much more to come.
You sound like you're absolutely buzzing, which is great. Thank you very much indeed. Paul Larbey from Bango here on Proactive.
Thanks, Katie.